office is actually a promising sign. It means he has a job, so we'll see what he has to say. Hi, Nico.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet
I'm
you,
Elizabeth.
Too.
Thanks so much for having us here today.
Okay, great, excellent. Let's get started.
Nico was doing an internship at an IT company where he now works full-time when he found out he was selected for Finland's basic income trial.
When you first found out that you were going to be part of the trial, did you tell people or did you want to keep it secret?
When I first received the letter, I opened it, I didn't understand it at all, and so I give it to my wife and ask her about her what the heck is this.
Mika had been unemployed for 16 months before he decided to go back to school to switch career paths into IT.
Do you find there's less bureaucracy than there was when you were receiving benefits for being unemployed?
Yeah, definitely, and that's the best part of the basic income, that it would mean much less bureaucracy. People who are using the system are already using the system. The basic income encourages people to do work.
Mika said the 560 euros a month wouldn't be enough to live on, but it's given him flexibility for things like a family vacation or the possibility of starting his own business. He's proud to be part of the experiment in Finland, but he's not sold on the idea that you should continue receiving free cash even when you're well off.
There's no getting out. If I won $1 million at the lottery, they would still give it to me.
It's a pretty weird idea.
it's strange.
Our next step was to find out what the researchers think about the universal basic income experiment so far. Kela is the arm of the Finnish government that's implementing the trial.
So we are at the office here at Kela in Helsinki. We're about to meet with one of the main researchers now.
Researcher Miska Siimamainen said he won't actually hear from any of the participants until the trial concludes at the end of 2018. But the experiment has already revealed one of the biggest issues with universal basic income, funding.
We had to make many practical compromises during the design process of the experiment.
Researchers only had enough funding to hand out cash to 2,000 people. And they chose to limit their sample to participants who were unemployed.
Do you envision a world where eventually there could be everyone in Finland has universal basic income?
There is a strong consensus between political parties that the current social security system should be reformed.
But we found there is disagreement about how to reform the system.
It's the idea that universal basic income is actually going to take the place of some of the other benefits here in Finland.
That's the way that the discussion is, that if we're going to give you universal basic income, then we're going to cut from other sectors.
This is Antti Ohanen. He's the author of a book about welfare in Finland. He sees universal basic income not as a way to replace the current welfare system, but as an added benefit.
Our path shouldn't be to create low-wage jobs, but to really, you know, improve education and improve people's skills. And I think giving the kind of freedom that true universal basic income would provide might help with that.
It looks like the trial is off to a good start here, but it still seems like it's a long way away from universal basic income being universal here in Finland. Hey guys, it's Elizabeth. Thanks so much for watching. If you want to check out more of our story, that was to find out what the researchers think about the universal basic income experiment so far. Kela is the...
So, before we watch another one, what did you think about that then? Any thoughts, comments?
I'm not sure, really. I don't know if there should maybe be an upper limit, like the person on the trial said, if I won the lottery tomorrow, I'd still be getting this money. So it just seems a bit, but then it's kind of backtracking on what it's all about, giving it to everybody. But then it does seem strange that there'll be a big CEO of a company on God knows how much, and they're getting 560 euros a month and they don't need it.
I mean, in theory, if it was in the UK, I suppose the Queen would get it.
Yeah, well, the Queen would get it. Business people would get it.
Let's watch another one, a little bit more in depth. There's several that you can watch at your own leisure. There's one, there's a BBC one that's like half an hour long.
Arm
of
the...
It might be good, but let's see if this one might be. Let me see if I can get this one. Maybe it's slightly higher. Oh, it's in job is helpful.
Shaman drums. He makes them. How much would you charge for this one, Sailor?
I think 300-400.
Not Finland,
Finnish people, they don't have money.
That's not the only business he's got going. There's filmmaking and an artist's version of Airbnb. All this while helping bring up 6 kids. Sort of.
All 3 kids sleep in these
beds? They are sleeping there, but quite often they are sleeping on the floor. Or on the trampoline.
They're sleeping on the trampoline?
Yes. I think the anarchist and
are you a bit of an anarchist?
Yeah.
Are you an anarchist dad?
Yes.
Had you swung by last year, things wouldn't have been half so jolly. Back then, jobless Juha was on dole money, which comes with such tight restrictions, he wasn't able to pursue any of his business ideas. But since January, he's been getting $660 a month, no strings attached.
What has a basic income made possible for you then?
It's make a possibility to create my own business. Before, I needed to focus for what employment office wants, and now I can focus what I want to do. So taking control of my life. Before it was employment office and government.
You get paid about $600 a month. What does that enable you to do? Is that a lot of money for you?
In Finland, 560 euros, it's very little money. You need to be vegetarian to survive with that money. So it doesn't make people just chill out or stay in their couches.
His apparently idyllic lifestyle forms part of one of the biggest economic experiments of our time. Universal basic income has rocketed in popularity since the banking crash. Bernie Sanders backs it, so does tech titan Elon Musk. Now Finland is hosting the first big trial in Europe. This isn't the purest form of UBI, which would be handed out to everyone, even billionaires. Instead, it focuses only on the unemployed. Still, there's a big jump between pilot and policy, and ministers know it.
What's the politics of actually giving people who are unemployed money just to sit at home?
I think it's not about just to stay at home, because I personally believe that in Finland, citizens really want to work.
Just as UBI freed Juha from being trapped on welfare, it could do the same for many others around the world.
In labour markets and benefit system, is the long-term unemployed person takes a short-term job, he or she might lose some benefits, and you get more money rather stay at home than going to work. But of course, I understand the criticism, because it's very open-handed, because you give the money and then you don't tax them, or then you don't ask what are you doing with the money.
The link between work and wages is at the heart of capitalism. Breaking it is opposed by some very powerful groups. In Finland, that includes the finance ministry and the country's largest trade union.
The problem is how to fund the benefits. Benefits have to be funded by taxation, and that's paid by the workers. If you pay everyone enough to live upon, that means that people don't have to work, which means that many people would quite rationally choose to work less.
You were saying it's unaffordable. How unaffordable is it? What kind of impact will it have on the economy?
Well, the current model being tested, if it were implemented on a national scale, would increase the budget deficit by 5% of GDP. A more realistic scheme would involve a much higher rate of taxation to fund the benefits, and a high rate of taxation means lower incentives to work.
What happens if we just give everyone money for nothing. Where's all the tax going to come from to pay for it?
There must be a lot of creative people, and they would create something new. After 10 years, we have a lot of new Facebooks, YouTubes, Uber taxis. So it's coded, I think, to our DNA that it's all the time developing. So that makes people, anyway, active.
So how do we feel about that then? What thoughts? Do you think people like this guy would set up their own businesses and stuff, or just what are your thoughts in general about that little video? I think that's probably the clearest one.
Not affordable.
Well, we'll see whether we would want to pay for it in England.
Because I feel sorry for that guy, because after this 2 year, after the end of this year, what's going to happen to him? He'll have to give up his little painting things and go back on the benefits.
Mm-hmm. Unless he's making his money from his food.
Unless he's saved loads aside. But he's going to go straight back onto it. He won't be able to do his business because he won't get his benefits.
I can't believe that he got six kids.
I know! God!
He's selling them at
300, 400 euros
each.
560 euros is £489 in like now money.
Yeah, so it's not
so
very
it's not
much.
Loads. It's like less than £500 a month.
And I don't know whether that's actually the amount that they wanted to go for, or whether that's the only
that's
budget.
That's just because of what,
the budget that they could get off the government to actually do it. I would have thought that they would want it to be quite a lot higher. Any other thoughts or comments about that? So that is an actual trial that's taking place, right now. Could you see that playing?
About people going, and you said as well, I think people go back.
Offer, because I'm what they love, like creative people having little ventures.
Mm.
But that means there will be less tax.
Yeah.
So it is important.
Unless you raise taxation, which is.
But then people won't want to work, and then it's just a vicious circle. Mm-hmm.
People do everything they can not to pay tax, don't they?
I suppose another aspect of it, talk about Karen, so if he's got a big family, that means he can spend more time with his family, I suppose. Don't drive you mad.
All of the six kids will get something too, won't they? So
well, that's the thing.
Six children.
In theory, they would all get it.
Yeah.
I don't know whether in the experiment whether it's just him that gets it.
Yeah.
But in theory, it's to every man, woman and child.
What happens here? Do you get money for
every
child?
Isn't there a cap now?
After your second child, you don't get any. It used to be as many kids as you want.
Really?
Yeah, they've capped it so that people don't keep.
When did they do that?
Just in the past year.
Last year, That's a
so
good
these,
idea.
These people with 12 kids.
No, they will. If
they've
already had 12 kids.
Because they've already had 12. In going forward, if you have more.
No, what a shame. I guess I'm sure that must have been an incentive for them. Imagine how much money you get a month just for having 10 kids.
Well,
child benefit alone.
Okay. Right, so let's. And again, I've got, if you want to, at your leisure, watch those other two. There's another one with that guy in it, and there's another one that's a BBC one that's nearly half an hour long. I didn't watch all of that, but might be quite more detailed. Showing some other different types of people that have done it. But anyway, we'll move past that for now. So this was another one, previous studies. And there have been several of the previous studies that, again, this Bregman book, if you can find some of his articles online, I'm sure he's got summaries of it. I've got a copy myself, but I'm interested in this kind of stuff, but I don't think there's a copy in the library, but you might be able to find some of these articles and things online that will give summarised versions. But there have been many different studies, and this one, Mincome, in Canada in 1974 to 79, in this little town called Dauphin, in Canada. Again, I think, I'm not sure how many people lived in that. I think it was about 4,000 people, so quite a small town. But for 4 years, thereabouts, a family, and again, I think it was done individually, I don't think children included, but basically the adults were, So if it was a family, you know, they got the equivalent of £16,000 a year in today's money. That's a lot of money. I mean, I suppose what's quite interesting is if you actually look at what's considered, I forget the exact term of it, but the government has a... The government considers you to be poor in the UK if a family of this, a family of two adults and two children, if that family has an income which is 60% or lower than the average income. So, and it's set £16,000. So if a family of four basically is earning less than £16,000, they're considered a poor family in the UK. So that's quite interesting. I mean, obviously it's not linked, but just made me think, well, right, so you could imagine that. Let's say if a family was given £16,000. That's a pretty, I mean, it would be poverty levels to actually live off if that's all you lived off. But it would put a really solid base under you. I mean, like you're saying, you could use to pay your mortgage and stuff like that.
But, yeah. You could get a house and get out of rent, couldn't you?
Mm.
So you're already on.
You got sound footing. Right, so this study, the actual results of this. So school performance increased as people stayed in education longer. Domestic violence reduced, Addie's mental health issues. It doesn't explain why, or it's a bit of a mystery why, but hospitalisation decreased 8.5%. Not quite sure what that was. Saving money on treatment. And work rates went down, but only marginally. Work went 1% for men and 3% for women as more took longer maternity leave. So it wasn't this, you know, everyone starts lounging about drinking booze all day. You know, it actually had positive impacts. Now, the reason why it didn't carry on, because they had a change of government to a government which was more like, well, this is just, why should everyone else be paying for these guys to get money? And they didn't go down that route. But if you look into and maybe read the articles a bit more, you can find more, you know, detailed information and other ones, studies that took place. Even in America, there were studies that took place. And it seems like, from the ones that I've looked at, that, you know, on the whole, it does have a positive effect. And the people don't become idle.
Yeah.
There's even some more radical versions of this, not universal basic income, but some of the examples that I was looking at was in some parts of the chapter he's talking about this charity that I've never heard of before. It's called something like givedirectly.com. And what they do is, you know how you give money, let's say you gave money to Oxfam, and Oxfam distribute the money to people that need it. This Give Directly is, they, let's say someone's in Africa and they're poor but they want to start up a business, they give the money directly to that person and then they get on with their business. And apparently that's even more successful. They just give people, it's just giving money directly to people and they do their project.
Which is good because it cuts out, I'm sure there'll be a bit of a fee,
yeah,
but it cuts out like however much the Oxfam person is getting paid.
Yeah, there's an administration that sort of do some organisation.
Oh yeah, but it won't be as much.
Yeah, it's not as though you give the money to Oxfam, then Oxfam takes that money and spends it as they
wish.
Yeah.
Going wherever you, yeah.
It's a bit like Patreon. If you've ever heard of
Patreon. Oh, yeah, you mentioned it, yeah.
But it's more of a, it's aimed at sort of poor countries. And it's not just you give them money and they have a project that they want to do and you give it to them. And that's meant to work pretty well and create a lot of businesses in Africa, apparently. So, I mean, I'd be interested if I'd had more time to look in maybe some other studies, but from the ones that I've looked at, it does seem to have, it'd be interesting to see when this study comes, the results of the finished study comes out, what actually happened, because that's obviously modern. But shouldn't we all be jumping for this now and going for it before we come and actually have a look at how much it's going to cost in the UK, the people who are putting it forward?
If I got chosen for a trial, I would keep all of the money, wouldn't spend it and save it, and then it would just be free money for my house that I'm going to buy.
Yeah.
You'd just go, oh, thanks. So it wouldn't make any difference to my working. I'd just save it and pretend I never had it. So that,
well,
yeah,
you don't have to justify how you spend it. So
yeah,
if you want to save,
it'd just get siphoned away.
Yeah.
It'd just be like direct standing order straight out, and then I'd never see the money, so I'd never miss it. Just carry on the way that I'm going, and then after a year, you'd have 6 grand. Wouldn't you? Just sat there.
Okay. So, we've had a look around the world. Now I want to look at some of the ideas that are being put forward in the UK. The Scottish government's got an idea, but one of the main organisations, it's the RSA, it's the Royal Society for the Arts, and they're kind of like a charity, quasi-government body. And they've done a load of research, and they've actually put forward a proposal of how they, and there are other organisations that put forward proposals, but for the sake of time, just focus on the RSA, because they've seen the most development. They put forward how it would pay for, who would get it, how much it would be. It's a universal basic income, but they have got different bands. So if you're a pensioner, you get more. If you're a child, you get less. If you're an adult, you get this, that, and the other. But we'll come to that in a second. Okay. So let's have a look at this then. Right. So here we are. Karen. So how much is all this going to cost? Okay. So let's look at a model first off. So the RSA, the Royal Society for the Arts, as it's called. They actually do loads of research and stuff, like a research organisation. Sort of linked, quasi-charity, part linked to the government. Right, and they've done a lot of research on this. And so theirs is fairly modest. So they've put forward this proposal that they've worked out quite deeply. I've kind of summarised it. And they put forward this idea of for an adult, so from a 25 to a 64 year old, that you would get a UBI of £3,692 a year, which is lower than anything else that we've looked at. So maybe it's because they're costing, or maybe they're just trying to downplay it because what they want to do. Well, let me zoom out a little bit.
Mm.
There's
not a lot of difference that,
right? So they say that would cost £279 billion to run. They say that you would have savings of £272 billion because all the other benefits would become obsolete and you could save money on the admin. So it would be a net increase of £6 or £7 billion there, extra. Now, they would pay for that by scrapping £10,000 personal allowance and replacing it with a basic rate of interest on earnings up to £40,000. 40% tax on earners over 40,000, 45% tax on earners over 75,000, and 50% tax on earners over 150,000. So these are their costings. So at the moment, you'd still be better off if you want lower wage because you get UBI and it would be worth more than the tax that you would spend. But at the moment, you get £10,000 you don't pay tax on. The first £10,000 that you earn, you don't pay tax on. Under this model, they would actually get rid of that. And everyone who was earning up to £40,000 would pay 30% tax. So everyone would pay more tax, basically.
Mm.
But the you would still benefit from the universal basic income, even in the tax that you've lost. I'll show you some charts in a minute. What do we think about that? I mean, that's a low basic income for a start, and it's a lot more tax. I mean, I don't know if you're familiar with the tax brackets, but basically it's set up, if you earn up to £10,000, you pay no tax. If you earn £10,000 to £40,000, you pay 20% tax.
Mm.
And then if you earn £40,000 above, it's just 40% tax.
Yeah.
So they've sort of added in more bands, if you like. What do we think? Before I look at some charts that maybe make it a bit clearer. Do we think that would be worth getting that? I mean, their figures, it would be worth the individual's while, but...
It looks like some people might just break even.
Mm.
So then,
I mean, they've got some charts in there that if basically the poorer you are, the more you would be better off.
So on a job earning £20,000, your tax would be about just over £6,000, but then you'd get almost two thirds of it back.
Mm.
So you'd only be paying £2,308 in tax.
Mm.
So you'd only get each month £192
mm.
off your salary of £20,000. So yeah, you'd probably be slightly better off because
mm.
you're getting that money back that
mm.
you'd have otherwise paid in tax and not saved. That you're paying higher tax, but then
if you look at that document, it's freely available on PDF. Maybe I'll bring it up. It does show the kind of rate. So yeah, the poorer you are, the more it makes sense.
Yeah,
it's not that one, but. Here's the sort of bands that they're talking about. So they've got, it's not a pure universal basic income, because that should be everyone the same. So I suppose that's that one that's the amount you would get and the amount of people. So the one that I put on the board was 25 to 64 year olds, so 33 million people would get 3,692. If you're a pensioner, you get 7,000. If you're a child, getting £4,290 a year. Nice little savings for you when you get older, you get a nice mortgage on that.
Yeah.
I suppose it would be more of a, it seems more like it would be a way of building up future generations, perhaps.
Yeah. But would the money be in their name and have to go to a bank account in the child's
mm.
name, or would it be as a family
mm.
thing?
Yeah.
And you'd kind of, you'd get it and you'd spend it for the benefit of the child,
mm.
like putting a roof over their heads, keeping warm, feeding them, clothing them.
I mean, I didn't have a chance to
yeah.
read it really deeply. My impression was that it is something that goes directly to the child.
To the child, so then, yeah.
So then we've got our figures.
Trying to get on the housing market then, would you? Because at the moment they can't get onto the housing market, can they?
So it's not an absolutely, totally pure basic income model, because a pure basic income model would be
everybody gets equal,
so, yeah. Regardless of anything, just as a citizen you get it. So again, this is what they're saying they could make a saving with. All those benefits would be collapsed into, combined basically into the basic income.
Student grants and loans written off.
So again, this isn't the government, this is an organisation
yeah,
that's
yeah.
thought
well,
really deeply
gonna, yeah.
and said, this, but the thing is, the Scottish government is, these trials, they're working with this.
Oh, have they?
Yeah. And there, this is the tax bracket. So that's kind of how it is at the moment. I'm not quite sure I exactly understand that, but basically you've got zero tax and people in 10,000, not quite sure why it jumps up like that, but basically that's how they got these steps going up. I'm not quite sure the tax system there, but that's what they propose. This is a guy trying to explain it.
The idea of a universal basic income is not a new idea. It's been around for a number of centuries. But it's essentially a very simple form of supporting people in their lives. So everyone, whether they're a child, an adult, of pensionable age, will get a weekly payment from the government, basically to support them in whatever they want to do in their lives. The benefits are actually enormous, and I put them in three terms: security, simplicity, and freedom. It gives you a secure basis on which to build your life. Whether you want to set up a business, you want to learn, you want to work, you want to care for others, you've always got this basic security. It's simple. The current welfare system is incredibly complex. With every change that we've seen over the last 2, 3, 4, 5 decades, it's become more and more complex, difficult to understand, difficult to administer, and we pay about £8 billion a year to maintain this complex system. And freedom. Because you have this basic security, because it's simple to understand, you can get on with your life, build your life, make a difference, fulfil your creative potential. What changes would it mean for the tax system? Well, once you include tax credits, the current system looks like the Himalayas. So if you're at the low level of earning, you have a very steep mountain to climb. Our system is different. You don't get a personal allowance in the basic income system, but you do retain a basic income when you start working, so that compensates you for that. So it's slightly more if you're earning over £75,000. Elsewhere in the tax system, you're compensated by the basic income payments if you're a family.
Yeah, I suppose that what that means is that's kind of the drop-offs, you know, when people talk about, well, if I earn over this, suddenly I'm going to lose my benefits, etc. Mm. But having had a little look at that then, what do you think of that, that's one proposal for paying for it?
I'd be interested to see how it works in Glasgow or Edinburgh. Or
And then, so if I'm linking to... So yeah, trials 2017, the Scottish Government announced £250,000, so again, not a great deal of money, for 4 2-year trials, 2018 to 20 in Glasgow, Fife, North Ayrshire and Edinburgh. Glasgow, well, the Glasgow project, so they're going to do it in different ways and sort of see which is the best way.
Yeah.
The Glasgow one, they're going to do the RSA model. Now, it'll be different because it's going to be through a council, so I'm not quite sure. I mean, I suppose they'll get the money through. I suppose it won't be so much the tax side of it, it'll be the different bandings, because if they're getting the money from central government. So Glasgow is going to follow what the RSA have put forward, but the other ones have got kind of their own ideas. So yeah, if you're living in Glasgow, Fife, better move up there quick and see if you can.
I was thinking that, I must go.
Get a letter through your postbox. So by 2020 we will know what the results of these studies have been. So how do we feel about that so far then, Karen? Sound as attractive as it?
No.
I think it would have to be way higher, and of course then the tax would have to be really high, or the government could borrow money, which then is another problem.
I think it would just like break even, like, it's hard to say really, because I don't know how much you get on benefits either. It doesn't seem like very much, does it, Mike?
No.
How much do you get on benefits? I don't know.
You probably get a hell of a lot more than 3,000, because people get like the housing benefit paid, like all of the rent.
But they're saying
they don't pay council tax.
They're going to do away with all that benefit system and just give them 3,000.
I suppose it would help in people in work more.
Yeah, but what? I don't know. Because the tax, you're paying extra tax, aren't you? You're paying 30% tax, and you've lost your 10,000 personal allowance as well. The thing that worried me was when you said they were going to do away, you've got to start paying for the NHS and stuff.
Oh no, that was what some people suggested. That's not this model at all. No, that's what some people have, bandied about, that idea. Sort of pro-capitalist. Okay, so what do we think then? In conclusion, is UBI the wave of the future or an encouragement to idleness, or do we just think it's unworkable?
I think it just takes so much planning, and what always happens with these schemes is that 4 years or whatever it works, and then another government comes in and gets rid of it all, and then they try to start something else up, but then they're never in for long enough to actually see it through to an end, or see if it'll actually get good results. So everybody would have to be on board with it, everybody would have to agree. It'd have to be long term.
It's not going to encourage idleness, because it's not enough money. And it's not going to help the people that are on benefits, because it's not enough money.
about Finland. I mean, it came up there. Finland is a country of 5 million people. The UK is 60-odd million.
Yeah.
They've got a problem with scale because they've got more money to spend on fewer people in Finland.
Yeah.
Because they are a rich country.
Yeah, because I thought they were.
So, you know, some of these projects might not work in the UK with so many more people, even though we are
yeah.
richer in absolute terms, because there's so many more people, the money's going to be spread more thinly.
Go to that last slide so I can just copy down the name of the report on that pink thing.
Yeah. It's also in the bibliography. But again, that is, if you were talking about, you know, where does it balance out, I didn't put them on there, but it's got several charts that show, you know, how it would dip down. There were some that, where it shows that, so before and after, and it's got, would you be better off or worse off, and there are some groups that would be worse off.
Right.
If you're very rich, you're obviously going to be worse off, because you're going to be paying more tax, a lot more tax, but you're only going to be getting $3,500.
Yeah.
But it's still very wealthy anyway, so the amount of jet
to pay. Was rich to leave the country, wasn't it?
Well, possibly. Yeah.
I'm just trying to stay still so that I finally stopped coughing.
Yeah.
So if I stand up, I don't want to risk it.
So, yeah, at the end of that, how do we, before we have a look at some essay writing skills and stuff, how do we feel about?
I feel like when we did something else the other week, I was determined I was going to write about that in the essay, but now I think I'm going to do universal basic income and precarious work and how it works hand in hand.
Yeah, yeah.
So I just think there's a lot to write about. And obviously, the universal basic income is to try kind of solve precarious work, so I guess it goes hand in hand.
Mm.
There's some interesting ideas.
Yeah, there is. But then at the end, my conclusion will probably be that it's a good idea and it's got good basis, but it won't solve the problem.
Mm.
So that'll probably be the conclusion.
Mm-hmm.
But all the way through, there'll be so many for and against, won't there?
And there are other studies. There was one that I didn't have time to include, but by another organisation called Compass, who came up with a kind of a different, a different model, slightly different.